Hello, this is Dave, and you continue to be just the wonderful podcast listener that you are. This is another episode of 80s Reboot Overdrive, and I'm going to continue my quest. Yes, I'm using the word quest because, well, you know what? I'll get into that in a second. But this is my continuing saga of my favorite 1980s Saturday morning cartoon show. We're all the way up to 1985 already. Wow. Kind of excited, you know, just because I'm kind of working my way through and getting this series done for you, which I know a lot of times I have these grandeur ideas and I'm like, oh, I'm going to do this or I'm going to do that. And I get myself hyped up about it. And then somewhere along the way, things kind of, interest wanes, or I guess I'm not getting enough feedback, or I don't know, you know, what the deal is. But in this case, I am glad that I'm barreling through this, because I made a commitment to you guys, and I want to keep it. Damn it. Like I said, we're on the 1985 Saturday morning cartoons, and I want to get going on the show here. So let's just get right into the bumper and just get things going for you. Okay, so here's this first. I wasn't ready, but I am now, so let's do it.
Lord of Omens, give me sight beyond sight.
Greetings, Starfighter. You have been recruited by the Star League to defend the frontier against Zur and the Kodan Armada. Get ready? Prepare for blast off.
Hey, Doc, we better back up. We don't have enough road to get up to 88. Roads? Where we're going, we don't need roads.
Remember, no matter where you go, there you are.
This is 80s Reboot Overdrive Podcast.
Oh my god, that is like so dated.
All right, so here we are. We're in the Saturday morning cartoons of 1985. So as I've done before, I looked at the schedule of stuff that was on. And looking at the schedule that's in front of me, there's some fun stuff in here. So we're gonna get right into this. So, at the beginning of 1985 in the morning, looking at the spring hour, and the reason I'm going to be scrolling up and down is because this chart is so I don't see the time frames. At 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock on ABC, there were Super Friends. And the CBS, 8 to 8:30 was Shirt Tales, and 8:30 to 9 o'clock was Get Along Gang. On NBC, in the spring of 85, we had from 8 to 8:30 the Snorks. It doesn't say that, it's just Snorks. So I don't remember if on that cartoon when I played it before, was it the Snorks or just Snorks? I'm guessing just Snorks. 8:30, that would have been Pink Panther and Sons. And then fall of 1985, we had the Bugs Bunny Looney Tunes Comedy Hour on ABC. On CBS, 8 o'clock would have been Berenstain Bears going into the Wuzzles. Did I say that right? Wuzzles. And then NBC on 8 to 8:30 still had the Snorks on in the fall. And then that would have led us to Disney's Adventures of the Gummy Bears. We're going to stop right there and play an intro that I just think I didn't watch this cartoon hardly much at all. In fact, maybe just one or two episodes. But the theme song is just so iconic and it sticks with you. So let's play that.
Dashing and daring, courageous and caring, faithful and friendly with stories to share. All through the forest they sing out in chorus, marching along as their song fills the air. Gummy bears bouncing here and there and everywhere. Along with the secret of gummy berry juice, the legend is growing. They take pride in knowing the fight for what's right in whatever they do. Gummy bears bouncing here and there and everywhere. High adventure that's beyond compare. They are the gummy bears. They are the gummy bears.
All right, so before you like say, okay, Dave, you didn't watch Gummy Bears. What is wrong with you? Are you, like, not American or something? Gotta look at the age group that I was in at this time. We're talking 1885, so I would have been 14 years old. 14-year-old boy. I don't know. The Gummy Bears just wasn't on the radar at the moment. I knew they were on. I may have caught an episode or two, but for some reason, it just wasn't one of those things that I would have gravitated to. You know, I mean, I've already told you guys about liking Dungeons and Dragons and the Littles and Saturday Supercade. So I mean, we've already talked about all that stuff, and so I don't want to defend myself to say that, you know, the reason why I wasn't watching the Gummy Bears was just I was too old. But now, you know, I probably was. You know, I mean, Super Friends was still on. That would have been my go-to show. And I think that between that and Bugs Bunny Looney Tunes, that you know, that was my thing. So don't judge. I didn't watch Gummy Bears. I appreciated it for what it was. But for those of you that would have been younger at that time frame, you know, that probably would have been something that you would have wanted to watch. You know, I, you know, in all honesty, I've never really been a big fan of the candy either. So maybe that was it. Maybe I didn't have a connection with the sweet stuff. I didn't dislike it, but I just never gravitated as the I've got to have the gummy bear candy. But, yeah, so, but I wanted to play that theme song because it's iconic, you know, once you hear it, it kind of, you know, and that really just kind of sticks with you and you're like, well, this is, you know, fun. And, you know, that's really it. You know, I remember when we talked about our favorite 80s cartoons on the podcast with, when I had my, you know, co-host on. I know it was co-host Tim that actually was giving the words to that song. The bit that we were doing on that podcast was I was saying, you know, is there a cartoon intro that you can just say the words without singing them? And I remember him saying the words to the Gummy Bears. And it just sounded really funny. Because you expect to hear the theme song. Gummy Bears. Oh, that was bad. Oh, I got to edit that out. Maybe I won't. I'll leave it in there. All right, so what are we talking about? I have this undying appreciation for an audiobook. I have mentioned this in the past. It's been on many of episodes where I've referenced it, but I'm now currently probably listening to it for the audiobook for what's now, I'm sure, is the 10th time. Ready Player One by Ernest Cline. Those of you that are in the know realize that, you know, it's soon to be a major motion picture, made by Mr. Steven Spielberg. So what I wanted to do was, even though I am fluent with the story now, I wanted to reacquaint myself with the magic that is the source material. Before we get later on in the year and the movie comes out, and even though it's Spielberg, even though the trailers, the teasers look really great, I'm just worried. I'm just worried because it's a story that I know very well now. And I just know that when you get into trying to change something into a movie format, you've got to take some editorial privileges to get that into a condensed version for a hour and a half movie. And with all the trademark material that's mentioned in that book, even though it's Steven Spielberg, I'm worried that a lot of those great 80s references in the book aren't going to make it onto the big screen. And I don't think that they have enough time in a regular movie format to get all that stuff in. So at this point, as I'm re-listening to the book for the 10th time, I find myself worried what's going to get cut, what's not going to make it in, what sequences. And I know, I'm afraid that it's going to upset me when I see the movie. But I want to love it. I want it to be maybe one of those movies that becomes, you know, for like us fans of the 1980s, maybe it becomes like our Rocky Horror Picture Show. One of those things where you see it over and over and over again. I don't know, but I hope. And actually, I got something else that's kind of expanding on a thought from Ready Player One. But I, like I said, I just love the audiobook as read by Will Wheaton. If you can get Wesley Crusher reading, you know, an 80s pop culture infused love affair book, 80s infused, let's say 80s love affair for the 80s book. Well, I just really stumbled through that. Yeah, I won't edit that out. I'll leave that around because, you know, it's fun to hear me stumble, I think. I hope you feel the same because, well, you're still listening. All maybe, what, 4 or 5 of you. But, you know, just to hear his delivery and his pitch, his excitement. There's a reference to even when he's getting to do where he's sounding like Max Headroom in the audiobook. And I think he does it really, really well. It's fun. And it just, in his voice, it sounds like he really loved reading the material. He really got into it. Big props to Will Wheaton. But the story itself, and the point that I just, and I usually listen to it when I'm commuting to and from work, and the point I'm at now is where he just found the second gate. So he had the jade key, and he just found out the location of the second gate, the jade gate. Is that right? Jade Gate. The second gate, regardless. And it had a reference to Blade Runner. And it was just really great, you know. And even though I've listened to it now 10 times, I catch myself anticipating what's going to happen next, knowing what's going to happen next, but like thinking to myself, okay, that's just too easy. Why didn't he get that clue? He should have gotten that a lot faster. And I've had the luxury of hearing the story 10 times, so I know what's going to happen next. But in my mind's eye, I'm just wondering, you know, why aren't these characters getting these clues faster? And then as I'm thinking that, something else I wonder about, and I guess it was never really addressed. You know, we have this great tool called the Oasis. And what I wonder about is, why doesn't he have, like, a Google-like tool to look up things? You know, because if you had a clue that was referencing, you know what? I don't know if I want to spoil it. Those of you that haven't read the book, there's a reference to Zork. But the clue that he had to look for to find out where to go next, I think the first time I heard the book, I kind of got it right away. But I'm just thinking, if you would have used the first line of the clue, or not the first line, but whatever line it was that talks about the abandoned house, maybe he could have figured that out a lot quicker by doing like a Google keyword search. So why doesn't the Oasis have something like that? Now, the other part that's the dilemma there is, if they did have that kind of tool and it moved that quickly to figure out the next clue, then I guess the book would go too quickly. So I kind of answered my own question, but I just wanted to think that through out loud with you guys. So I don't know if those of you that are Ready Player One fans, if you thought the same thing or not. I'd be interested to know that. Shoot me a message, smoke signal, tweet, and say, you know what? I'm a fan of Ready Player One, and I was wondering the same thing. But let's move further into the 1985 cartoons. We are now at the 9 o'clock time frame. And on ABC, you would have gotten, and I paused there because I hit something on my iPad. I want to make sure it didn't start doing something. Spring of 1985, ABC, 9 o'clock, Mighty Orbots. At 9:30, you would have had Turbo Team. CBS, you would have had Jim Henson's Muppet Babies. And at 9:30, that would have been Dungeons and Dragons. NBC, in the spring of 1985, starting at 9 o'clock, would have been Smurfs, all the way up until, what's that, 9:30, 10 to 10:30. Wow, that's a big block. ABC, in the fall of 1985, had Ewoks, and then that would have went at 9:30 to Droids, The Adventures of R2-D2 and C-3PO. Fall of 1985, Jim Henson's Muppet Babies and Monsters. So that was on for an hour. And then fall of 1985, they left Smurfs right where it was on NBC on that hour and a half block. So that was on for quite a while. So let's bring something up that's kind of fun. And I kind of been eyeing this one because I thought, I'm looking forward to playing the intro on this. And I would have, you know, a good host would have had that queued up already, right? But I don't. So don't hate me. And here we go.
Earth, the 23rd century, a time of robots and aliens, and of destruction and terror. Can the Galactic Patrol, Defender of the United Planets, stop the evil computer Umbra? You bet they can. Meet Rob Simmons, the secret inventor of Feisty Ono, Mighty Tor, Versatile Bort, Elusive Boo, Bo, the master of the elements, and Crunch, the metal muncher. Super robots forging together at Rob's command to form Mighty Orbots, champion of the universe.
Go, Mighty Orbots. They're joining together to fight for what's right everywhere. Mighty Orbots, protecting the world from the shadow of evil and doom.
right, that was Mighty Orbots. Yeah, I don't know. Why did I not pick Ewoks and Droids? I don't know. And actually, did I pick Mighty Orbots on 1984? I did. I really did. I think I just did a did that twice in two podcasts in a row. So let me throw in something else that I haven't done yet. And we are going to listen to something else, and that way it gives me a little more ammo of doing new things for you guys. And actually playing these intros is kind of cool too. So, same kind of theme. We had robots, but this time we're picking on droids. The Adventures of R2-D2 and C-3PO. Yeah, and that was... Ewoks started before that. And I don't know enough Star Wars lore and backstory. So, I'm wondering, did George Lucas have any involvement other than having his name on that? Did he help with story development? Did he help figure out how that stuff is going to blend into the Star Wars canon universe? Or did he just go, yeah, you have my permission to make it a cartoon and just go with it? I know that he wasn't a fan of one of Scott's movies that he likes to watch, and that's the holiday special for Star Wars. So I'm wondering, was Ewoks and Droids cartoons the same kind of thing? You know, where it had the Star Wars namesake and the characters, but there wasn't really, other than that, it was just kind of the... Yeah, that kind of thing's out there. And you can, you know, you're a kid, you can go enjoy that. But that's not really what Star Wars is supposed to be. Or did he ever even come out and say stuff like that? Did he, you know, did he even give it any attention? Did he even acknowledge that stuff? Other than to just say, just give me my paycheck. So I don't know. I don't know that much about what was going on there. But I'd be curious to... You know, just somebody filling me in. Like I said, I like Star Wars and I like what I've been given from the mass media. But I really didn't give those cartoons that much time, a little bit of time, but not that much. Yeah, I don't know if, that would have been something that George Lucas was like, yay, let's make some cartoons. And speaking of cartoons, what I want to do is give a quick shout out to my friend Charlie Esser, who's over there on GammaCast that you guys may listen to on the 80s Reboot Overdrive channel. He's the one that's been handling the Incredible Hulk podcast for a while now. I mean, I started that journey with him, but I checked out. And that was just because I'm not one to get locked into scheduling too hard. And so when, I felt that I was being a hindrance to schedule the show to coincide with what was being aired on MeTV, then I would, I was like, I feel like I'm not helping progress. But I brought him up because he actually gave me some feedback on our 1983 Saturday morning cartoon show. And I wanted to read that. And this was a message from Charlie to me. He says, hey, FYI, was a pretty fun show for me as a kid. He's talking about Meatball and Spaghetti. There was a fat guy, Meatball, kind of scruffier play on Meatloaf, and his wife Spaghetti, who traveled the country doing gigs and having adventures. They were kind of a played across between the Honeymooners and Burns and Allen. Spaghetti being a smart, dumb blonde like Gracie Allen, with Meatball as sort of a Ralph Camden loudmouth schemer. There was also a Norton-esque best friend character, and I believe a smarter than any human dog character. I don't think it lasted a season, but it certainly stuck with me 30 years later. He said that it was a childhood favorite cartoon of his. I told him on my response that the intro looked fun. He says it was. He had no idea it holds up to his memory since he had only a clear remembrance of a single episode. They build a Marvin-esque robot roadie, but it stuck with him through all these years. So I think that's really kind of cool. I appreciate the input there. Shout out to Charlie for, you know, giving me the lowdown of a little bit more about Meatball and Spaghetti, which I asked for. So, once again, I encourage everybody to give me the similar kind of feedback and input. You know, there's stuff that I'm missing on these podcasts. I'd like to hear your input. You know, you can tweet, you can email 80sreboot@gmail.com, and as I get those, I will I'll read them out. Thank you, Charlie. I was talking about Ready Player One. And something else that had kind of, I thought was a fun concept is the Easter egg contest. As I'm listening to the book now for what I say the 10th time, I'm thinking to myself, you know, if I had the ability, like in, you know, upcoming podcast adventure that I was doing, to build in some sort of Easter egg thing where you had to like find clues within the podcast, that would be kind of fun. That would be really, really cool that, you know, if you had, you know, you were an avid listener of a podcast series and just a spoken word dialogue between guests, co-hosts, and every show there was some sort of thing that as you listened to them all, you pieced it together, you would get a clue and it would tell you to go somewhere and do something. That would be kind of really awesome. And I don't know if I have anything that's worth giving, you know, that would be the motivation to do that kind of a thing. But I love the idea, you know, and I don't even know how that would be possible. You know, during a normal conversation, you know, that you were to throw in something random that would work in conjunction with a series of episodes. And you don't tell anybody about it. You don't even say that it's out there. And you just hope one day that somebody gets those little breadcrumbs and puts them together. And then you have them go somewhere to do something. That would be kind of magical. If you were a fan of something, you know, like a general podcast that just seems unassuming, and still it led you somewhere, and you had that, you know, this is really cool kind of thing. And it'd be really great if it just led to gobs of money and ownership of the Oasis, which is the prize, you know, for Ready Player One. But, you know, I don't have that kind of thing. So there's nothing that I'd be able to give. So it almost feels like it would be just like if I were to create like some sort of, oh, that's it. There you go. Oh, perfect. Here you go. I thought of it. What we do is we create, like Activision had, those patches, right? Like, you know, for all the different Activision games for Atari 2600. And we could create customized patch that if somebody were to gather the Easter eggs and figure out where to go to, you know, maybe it's a secret website. You go in and you'd have to fill out the form that, you know, that the clue led you there. And you'd be able to get like the achievement patch. Oh my God, that's really kind of awesome. I would do that. Would you? Let me know. You know how to get a hold of me. Maybe that can be a thing. I don't know. But I love the idea and just talking it out loud and thinking it through. How hard would it be to make a achievement patch? And I'd want it to be a real thing. I'd want it to be something that somebody would be able to get in the mail. I wouldn't want it to be just some sort of, you know, you've earned this achievement patch online or something. You know, like you get some sort of virtual achievement. I mean, that's cool and all that for if you play in like, you know, Xbox One games and, you know, all that stuff. But, you know, we're 80s kids. We need something to come in the mail. We need the mail away thing that you wait by the mailbox every week and wondering when you're going to get it. You know, think of Ralphie waiting for his Orphan Annie decoder ring. You know, we need that kind of thing. And I think an achievement patch that says that you found the Bonsai Retro Club achievement, you know, that would be kind of awesome. Oh well, that's me just thinking out loud and spitballing. I don't know if that's even going to become a thing. If I did, then that would be kind of great. Let me digest that a little more. I don't know if that's ever going to become a thing, but that's really kind of cool, in my mind at least. I don't know about you. But let's move on to the rest of 1985 here. And what time frame am I on? I'm at 10 o'clock already. At 10 o'clock, 1985, spring, ABC had Dragon's Lair. 10:30 had the new Scooby-Doo Mysteries. And we're just going to go through the rest of this. So 11 o'clock would have been Scary Scooby Funnies and then The Littles. CBS had Bugs Bunny Roadrunner all the way up until, see, 9, 9:30, 10 o'clock. So the 10:30 would have been VidKids. NBC at the... see, I hate this grid. See, I've got to do something better here. Maybe I'm going to export this and look at it through Excel or something. 10:30 would have been Alvin and the Chipmunks, Kid Video, and then that would have went into Mr. T. So that was the spring of 1985. Fall of 1985, ABC, I complained before. I'll do it again. Candlepin Bowling. Who in the world decided to put that on in the middle of cartoon hour or hours? And then ABC decided to put sports on after that. And then CBS had Hulk Hogan's Rockin' Wrestling. And then that would have went into VidKids. And then Dungeons and Dragons, wrapping up the Saturday morning cartoon time frame on CBS. In the fall of 1985, NBC would have given us Punky Brewster, Alvin and the Chipmunks, and Kid Video. Let me see, have I played that yet? Is that the first year this has been on? All right, there are two in here that we've got to play. We just have to. So let's do one first. We'll do the one that is cool, but but it's not the predominant one I've been wanting to get to. So let's try this on for size.
Guess the mystery on my show, the best show, Mr. T.
So that was Mr. T, and I realized that I had already played Good Video for you guys. So let's talk about Mr. T for a minute. So who remembers why he was hanging out with a bunch of gymnasts? I don't. I just remember the kid that was with him, I believe it was Spike, and the dog with the mohawk. Sure, I just saw the intro for that, but it didn't mention the kid's name. So I do remember that. And I know he was like a Mr. T wannabe, trying to be tough like Mr. T. You remember the beginning part where he's like, first name is Mr., middle name is period, last name T. So anyway, that was Mr. T. That was, 14-year-old boy, I was digging the A-Team when it was on. So there was a cartoon incarnation of, B.A. Baracus. Who wouldn't like that? So the thing that I had gotten excited about a moment ago where I was like, oh, I got to play this to you, for you because it's really cool. And that was the Kid Video thing. And I'm pretty sure I played that for the 1984 one because that was on at that point. I would have gravitated to that right away. So, you know what? Let's throw in another intro of one that I did watch because I want to talk about it briefly. So let's listen to this real quick. See, once again, you guys need to have, you need to give me somebody to run my iPad while I'm talking. I can give them like little handwritten notes to say, cue this one up so that you don't have to wait while I, type it in. But, you're having to wait for me. And you might be getting tired of that. Let's, you know what? For some reason, that did not come up really well. I'm going to be editing this show now because it's kind of hokey of you guys having to hear me do all this. All right, let's try this. Oh no, that's the promo. We want the theme song. That's my. That's not it at all. That's wrong. All right, let's try this.
Hi. How's the fishing doing today?
Fishing's lousy. I haven't caught a thing all morning.
I don't understand. That's a good spot. I used to get lots of fish in there.
I've been fishing since I was knee-high to a rebel run. It's all on the wrist.
You're the one. You want me to show you how to catch a fish?
Sure.
Yeah. I want some fish! So you.
Thank you.
could be so important about a letter that they gotta make you come to the post office for it?
I probably got so much fan mail, the postman couldn't carry it. While we're waiting, Nikolai, you might as well pass out some flyers for my upcoming match.
Hulk Hogan's Rockin' Wrestling will return after these messages.
Alright, well, I've just discovered that you just cannot find the Hulk Hogan Rockin' Wrestling intro very easily on YouTube. So I'm going to kind of stop there. I'm not going to spend more time looking for that intro. And really the reason I wanted to bring it up is because it's amazing how somebody's Latter-day Saints will kind of diminish how somebody feels about somebody. I don't know if you guys remember or not, but not too long ago, Mr. Hulk Hogan had said some inappropriate things about that made him appear. Well, actually, he very much sounds very much like a racist. On a recording that he had done on a phone call. That, it goes to say that he didn't realize he was being recorded or something along those lines. But it was something around the way his daughter was being, was dating African-American gentleman. And I don't have any tolerance for that kind of thought process. I don't think that anybody should be wired that way. Everybody's equal. And we should love each other. I know that's just me probably being naive. I'm not naive. I know everybody doesn't. But I don't like to hear people talk that way. And so Hulk Hogan, he's diminished now. You know, even though in the 80s, I used to watch WWF all the time. And I was a big fan of the Hulkster. But I also love the heel. I also like the bad guy. So I was big on Rowdy Roddy Piper. I love Piper's Pit. But back in the 80s, that was the jam, man. That was WWF wrestling. But this modern thing that happened with Hulk, it's like I don't want to give him any more time or credit. And I've feel the same way about Bill Cosby now. I feel the same way about Michael Jackson. And I want to like, you know, the talent that was Michael Jackson. But it's hard for me to get my head wrapped around how weird he became. And so many allegations of him having relations with kids underage. And I know, you know, none of that was proven. I know there was settlements. And say what you want about it. You know, does that make him guilty or not? I don't know. I'm not, you know, of a legal mind. But unfortunately, you get smeared by how things look. And Hulk Hogan ruined it. Michael Jackson ruined it. And, Bill Cosby, you continue to ruin it. Now, I know you don't listen to this podcast, but I just, you're lost, man. You're out there somewhere. There's no turning back for you. But it's just, you know, I don't want to hear, you know, of these people having these things that ruin the memories of the 80s. Sure, they're allowed to be human. They're allowed to be themselves. But my hope and my fantasy is that their selves are the best their selves they can be, which is what I attain to be or what I want to be. When you have things that happen like that become public knowledge, you you're no longer my hero. I've set the bar high for those of you that are still my hero, and please don't ruin it for me, because otherwise I may not be interested in talking too much about a cartoon that you were a part of in the 80s. Luckily, Mr. Rowdy Roddy Piper, you never did that, so I still have a lot of affection for the work that you did, and just a fun bad guy, just absolute fun bad guy that even translated into that cartoon. You know, as leader of the people that were against the good guys. So, you know, Mr. Hot Rod in his kilt. Gotta love it. So, that's where I'm at. I'm at the end of this show. That was the 1985 Saturday morning cartoons. As I've said in a few of the previous episodes, I'm going to get through the rest of the Saturday morning cartoons through the 80s. So I've got 86, 87, 88, and 89. So that's another, what, four? Is that good math? 86, 87, 88. Yep, four. And then a wrap-up episode with Scott and Rose and me. And that will be kind of a signing out of 80s Reboot Overdrive. Then, if you're interested in still tagging along with at least what I'm doing in Scott and Rose, we're going to be over at Bonsai Retro Club. That's going to be our new thing, our new network. And we hope that if you like the 80s content, then you'll like the decades that were the bumper of that, you know, the 70s and 90s, along with, you know, good stuff in the 80s. And we'll be able to continue to provide that content for you. So I'm hoping you're going to check us out there. And that's just simply www.bonsairetroclub.com. But I'm still doing this thing, 80s Reboot Overdrive, for now. So you still got me for a few more shows. And I'm going to continue to provide that to you, because that's what I'm going to do. And you can't stop me. Nah, 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 nah. So, signing off for this one. Let's get that outro bumper.
We hope you've enjoyed this show. This podcast is part of the 80s Reboot Overdrive channel on Southgate Media Group. You can follow us on Facebook on the 80s Reboot group page. We're also on Twitter and Tumblr at 80s Reboot. We invite you to check out all the wonderful podcasts and blogs available at southgatemediagroup.com. And thank you for reliving the 80s.
Let's see. You know what? It is going to be... It's Wednesday night, and I think my wife will be at home from the grocery store here shortly, and I'm going to be back in downstairs, and we will get on the couch and watch our favorite reality show together. What is that? Big Brother. So, I'm off to do that. You guys do what you're going to do, and I will catch you on the flip side.